As we reported earlier, the first batch of results from the 2020 census count are in, and the U.S. population topped 331 million last year. The Bureau also released state population numbers, which will reshape the balance of power in the U.S. House of Representatives for the next decade. Lisa Desjardins reports.
Good afternoon.
Rarely is a sedate Zoom call this politically dramatic.
The South grew the fastest over the last decade, with a 10.2% increase in population.
With jewel-toned backgrounds, U.S. Census staff announced population shifts that could change the red and blue balance in Congress.
Let's get to the results you've all been waiting for.
The Bureau showed three states in the South have gained enough population to add seats in Congress, Texas gaining two seats and North Carolina and Florida one apiece. The other three states adding one seat each are West, Colorado, Montana, and Oregon. In turn, seven states will lose one seat each, California, and then a cluster of Rust Belt states, West Virginia, Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, Illinois, and New York. For New York, some sting to the loss. Officials said the state needed to count just 89 more people to keep all of its congressional seats. Reporters triple-checked that.
Wow, that's a big loss for just 89 people.
I can just confirm that the number, when you calculate it, is 89.
This after the census and its army of workers faced a plague of challenges. Coinciding with a once-in-a-century pandemic was just one. The count is as critical as ever. It determines how many seats each state gets in the House of Representatives. And it guides at least $1 trillion to state and local governments for programs like Medicaid, Medicare, school lunches, and more. Hansi Lo Wong covers the census for NPR.
How big a deal is the announcement today?
This is a very big deal. This is a culmination of really a decade's worth of planning and execution last year. And this is a once a decade reset of the national political map.
Hence the massive drive for responses.
Counting everyone in your home helps support your neighborhood for the next 10 years by funding things like schools, hospitals, and buses.
But like so much in 2020, the census was hit with unprecedented acts of God and man. March 2018, the Trump administration adds a question asking if people are U.S. citizens. Ultimately, the Supreme Court blocks the idea, but it raises confusion and fear in some immigrant communities. January 2019, the partial government shutdown furloughs some census staff during a critical preparation time. March 2020, the coronavirus hits precisely as census forms are mailed out. The agency delays its field operations for almost 2 months. Then September 2020, hurricanes and wildfires across the country hit during the crucial final full month of counting.
The 2020 census was just a mess.
Wong says the layers of issues add to regular questions about undercounted groups, people of color, immigrants, and rural Americans.
For the 2020 census, all of these groups face a higher risk of being undercounted because the Census Bureau was really strapped to try to get door knockers out to communities while there were lockdowns in place, while there were major public health concerns, as well as the Trump administration cutting short the amount of time that door knockers had to reach these households.
Census officials today stood by their count.
We feel very confident that we did a good job of collecting data in spite of the COVID-19 outbreak.
Even so, states that lost, like New York, are sure to be unhappy, along with some states that gained, like Florida, which expected two new seats, not just one. It's too late to add more population, but states do have one option, to appeal these numbers in court. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Lisa Desjardins.
And to dive deeper into the political ramifications of the census data released today, I'm joined by Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report. So hello, Amy. Let's take that deeper dive and tell us a little more about how Democrats, Republicans are affected at the congressional level and then nationally.
Sure. Well, let's start with the winners. On the map, we saw that Texas was the biggest winner, picking up two seats. But you also notice something else here. Republicans have to be happy with the fact that Texas, Florida, and North Carolina all gaining seats. Not only are these states that President Trump, then President Trump, won in the 2020 election and the 2016 election. But they also are three states that are controlled completely by Republicans. So Republicans control the entire redistricting process in those states that are going to pick up four congressional seats. Democrats, you know, Oregon, Colorado, two states that Biden carried, President Biden carried in 2020. That is helpful to them. And then let's go to the losers. We have more states here, seven states that are losing one congressional district. For Democrats, you know, you look at those, some of those big dark blue states, the ones that are the pillars for the Electoral College sort of platform for Democrats to build on. New York, Illinois, California, all those states losing seats, not great for Democrats. Republicans losing a seat in West Virginia, that has become now the most Republican state in the country after Wyoming, and Ohio, a state that used to be a swing state, that's now much more Republican-leaning. Overall, though, Judy, if we're looking at the national picture right now, if we put this map into place for in the 2020 election, all right, so everything else remains the same, it would shift just three electoral votes away from Biden toward Trump. So instead of having 306 electoral votes in his victory, it would be 303 electoral votes. It doesn't seem like much, but Judy, when these races now are decided by just such a narrow margin, even one electoral vote can be critical.
Every single one, and one can matter. And Amy, tell us, what about in terms of drawing congressional district lines?
Right.
What are we learning about that?
That's right. This is apportionment. So this is the part where the states learn, did you gain or did you lose a seat? But the real nitty-gritty is going to come later this summer when the detailed data is released to the states and they have to start drawing those lines. That's where you're going to hear words like gerrymander. Even states that aren't gaining or losing, unless you're a state that only has one congressional district, you have to redraw your lines. Population shifted around a lot. Think about a place like Georgia, where the Atlanta suburbs have been booming, not so much in the other parts of the state. So they're going to have to readjust those congressional lines. You can gain or lose a seat as a party just because even if you're not gaining or losing a congressional district, right? The good news for Democrats, they have more control over the process than they did in 2010, the last time the lines were drawn. The bad news for Democrats, the good news for Republicans, is that Republicans still control more than twice as many congressional district lines in terms of they have total control for drawing that many more lines. That's likely to help, as I said, especially in places that are fast growing, Texas, North Carolina, but also in a place like Georgia, where Democrats have made really big gains in these last 2 years, but Republicans control the entire line drawing process. And so what you may see there is Democrats actually winning two Senate seats, but in the next upcoming election, they may lose a congressional district.
So much depends on who controls these state legislatures.